Good morning. It's good to see everyone this morning here in person, and also to have you on our different live stream methods that we have going on, either through YouTube or Facebook. It is just good to see everybody, and it makes me just feel like we're getting closer to normal, even though everybody looks like a bank robber here in church this morning with all the masks going on. But you do what needs to be done, amen? And it's just good to be here. It's good to see you. It's just good to gather, to know in my heart that we're gathering as a church. And not only that, but we're also doing all that we can to reach our community. It is such a blessing to see on Facebook and on YouTube the different folks that the ministry here reaches to around the world. We have people that every week watch us from Spain and in America and in different places around the world. And we even have someone here this morning visiting that started out 5 months ago watching online. And so, you know, all things work together for good to them that love God and called according to His purpose. So welcome this morning. We are glad to be together. And just a couple of notices before we open with prayer. Today at 1:30, Zing and Marcy will continue their Sunday school ministry to the children on Zoom. And if you would like some information about that for your children to join the Sunday school program, you can email me at info@chiswick.church, and we'll get all the Zoom information to you. Also, a reminder for the members of Chiswick Baptist Church, next Sunday after this service, we will have our annual general meeting. Now, Hazel has emailed everyone, all the members, with all that information, and I'm sure she'll put out a reminder again this week. And so if you have any questions about the AGM, about how it will be conducted through social distancing and everything, you can just email Hazel and get the information from her. Let's open in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much, Lord, for the blessings that you have poured upon us as a people. Lord, we look around and in our mind we see change, and we see not being sure about things, and you know, the anxiety levels are high with many people. But Lord, we as believers can be comforted with the fact that we know you're still in control. You always have been. You will never not be. And Lord, we trust you in all these things, and we are thankful that even in these difficult times, your glory and honor can be seen, can be felt, can be heard. And Lord, your work and your purpose and your plan and your love and your word is still going forth. And I just praise you for that this morning. Thank you, Lord, for those who are here for the first time today, several of them. And Lord, we're thankful for that. We're thankful for the members of our church who are here today and are part of the in-house portion of this service. And Lord, we're thankful for those who are watching online through the different ways. And Lord, I pray that all of us together, that you would in some powerful way unite us together as we come to worship you. And Lord, we come to hear your word. We come to just be among brethren, or even virtually be among brethren. And Father, I pray that more than anything this morning, that your truth would penetrate our heart, that we would understand it, that it would affect us, that it would change us. And Lord, that you would do in those who are Christians and those who are not, those who are far, those who are seeking, Lord, that you would do your will and do your work. And Lord, we'll just sit back in glory and amazement at the power that you have and the work that you do. And Lord, we just humbly present ourselves today and just ask you to speak. And Lord, we love you, and we pray for you to continue to work in your church and through your church to the community and to the world and to the people that's in our body. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Amen. Up here on the screen and on your screens at home, Let us just join together now as we worship together, as our team leads us in worship to the Lord. Amen.
Was blind, but now I 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieve. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. Promise good to me, His word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Will be
Amen. For those of you at home, you may take your Bibles and open to Mark chapter 7. We're going to look at the same text that we looked at last week, but at a different angle, a little bit deeper than we went last week. And for you here in the auditorium this morning, you may look up on the screen behind me, and the scripture will be there. Mark 7, verse 24 to 30. And the Word of God says, "From there, he arose and he went to the region of Tyre and Sidon. And he entered a house and he wanted no one to know it, but he could not be hidden. For there was a woman whose young daughter had an unclean spirit and heard about him. And she came and fell at his feet. The woman was a Greek, a Syro-Phoenician by birth. And she kept asking him to cast the demon out of her daughter. But Jesus said to her, 'Let the children be filled first, for it is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs.' And she answered and said to him, 'Yes, Lord.' Yet even the little dogs under the table eat from the children's crumbs. And he said, for this saying, go your way. The demon has gone out of your daughter. And when she had come to her house, she found the demon gone out and her daughter lying on the bed. She was healed. The demon was gone. Now I'd like you to take your Bibles again to Matthew chapter 15. We're going to read the parallel account in Matthew to this story in Mark. Same story, same account, same interaction, but Matthew gives a little bit more depth and breadth to some of the things that we don't get in Mark. And because I'm going to reference Matthew in this message, I thought it'd be great for us to read the parallel account in that gospel. So Matthew chapter 15, verse 21, and we'll read down to 28. Then Jesus went out from there, and he departed to the region of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a woman of Canaan came from that region and cried out to him, saying, have mercy on me, O Lord, son of David. My daughter is severely demon-possessed. But he answered her not a word. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, send her away, for she cries out after us. But Jesus answered and said, I was not sent except to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And then she came and she worshiped him, saying, Lord, help me. But he answered and said, it is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs. And that woman replied, yes, Lord, yet even the little dogs eat the crumbs which fall from their master's table. Then Jesus answered and said to her, O woman, great is your faith. Let it be to you as you desire. And her daughter was healed from that very hour. Let's just pray again. Father, I pray that the word that was read by the power of your Holy Spirit would resonate deeply and powerfully into each of us who hear this word. And Lord, I pray that you would enable me with the power of the Holy Spirit to be a voice, to be a vessel, to communicate not what I want or anything that I think about this text, but that I would only communicate what you, the Holy Spirit, has written and given to us to understand. And we pray these things in Jesus' name, amen. I know this is a little bit cheeky to promote a sermon that I've already preached, but if you did not hear last week's message, it would be good, even after hearing today's message, to go back and listen to that sermon from last week, for it will give you quite a bit of background, quite a bit of context to what Jesus is saying to this woman, especially when he says to the Jew first and being calling her a little dog and that kind of thing. And I won't go into that as much this week. So if you've not heard last week, it would be great if you could go back and listen to that. You see, the parallel account that we just read in Matthew, you might pick up a few differences, but there's nothing conflicting in the two stories. You see, when God, through the Holy Spirit, has his writers write, he uses their personality, but also he because there's four gospels, sometimes God emphasizes through that writer something different in this gospel and something different in that gospel. Doesn't conflict, there's nothing that's, you know, wrong with one of the others. It's just different. You know, it'd be like Jerry writing something and me writing something. He would do it in a different way than I would, and you'd get something a little bit different. It'd be like if two of us are outside in front of the church and we see a car accident and the police come and ask you, so what'd you see? And you'd see this and write it down and tell them, and then someone else would write it down. Same accident, but you'd get a little bit different input, right? And that's what you get from these gospels. See, Matthew's account simply brings some things out that enhances our understanding, and also I will refer to it this week, and that's why we read it. So what have we done so far in our text? Well, last week, we saw the character of God concerning the salvation of humanity in this text. We saw that the Lord does not offer salvation only to the Jews, or even primarily to the Jewish nation, but He is always and continues to offer salvation to the Jew and the Gentile alike. God's salvation was always towards all of humanity. Nobody, no religion, no gender, no nationality, no color, no anything has ever been outside of God wanting you to be His child and for you to be born again, have faith in Christ, and to enjoy Him for eternity. That has always been God's plan. But He came to the Jewish nation to be that methodology, to be that conveyance of the gospel to the world. God had to come into this world some way, and He did it through the Jewish nation. But He called out a Gentile named Abraham before they became that nation. So God has always offered and purposed salvation to the entire world through these people. And that's what we learned last week. And so as we've read our texts this morning, we need to understand two things are happening here. First thing that's happening is what we just said, that God is showing us that His plan of salvation has always been to the nations of the world. And we see that through Jesus lovingly and compassionately drawing this woman and her understanding of who He is and her understanding of faith out through this story. When He called her a dog, He wasn't being derogatory. He was telling her what the reality of her situation was and what the reality of ours is. And yet, through that story, we're seeing the character of God about salvation. He loves you and wants you to be His child. But secondly, God is showing us what faith looks like. He is showing us through the Syro-Phoenician woman who had no right, who had no real entrance as a Jewish person into this faith. And Jesus is showing us through her what real saving faith looks like. Or to phrase it another way, the Lord is showing us what it looks like to approach Him. What it looks like spiritually when a person approaches God in faith. It's the only way we can approach God. There can be no other way to approach God except through this way of faith that we see here in the message this morning in the text. So the title of this is simply The Character of Saving Faith. And I want you to just hold to that. I want you to just kind of keep your mind upon the text because I want to say something first. If you're a Christian this morning, you might be sitting here and thinking, great, I know this. I believe on the Lord Jesus. I have faith in Him. And now, you know, Pastor, you're bringing a message on saving faith. I've been here before. And what I urge you to do is do not turn off. Do not, like I have done so many times in my life, think, oh, I know this text. I'll just kind of wheeled over here a little bit and maybe write an outline while he preaches because I've been here before. I know the text. Don't do that. Because if you do, you might really miss what God is trying to say to you this morning. But I'll give you two reasons, really, why as Christians never turn off to even things, to things that you think you understand or you really do understand. Don't turn off to them because, especially in this text this morning, the reason we as believers need to continually to understand what saving faith is for these two reasons. Number one, so that you and I can constantly examine our faith to see if we're in it. You know, the Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians, examine your faith to see if your faith is genuine. Test yourselves. And this morning, you might be sitting here thinking, I've got faith, I've got faith, I've got faith. The question is, not do you have faith, not do you believe, but do you have saving faith? Do you understand what that true saving faith is? So we need to examine ourselves. And secondly, the reason as Christians we ought not to turn off because we think we understand this topic is this: we need to know what saving faith is so that we can properly witness to and lead others to that saving faith in Jesus Christ. So I'll make a statement this morning that might shock some of you. And we will get into the text in a moment, but I want to give a good introduction and foundation to this understanding. Saving faith is more than belief. I know that some of you might be going, whoa, wait a minute, Pastor. But let me say again, saving faith is more than simple intellectual assent to a truth. Saving faith, believing faith in Christ, is more than just understanding. Yeah, he's Son of God. Yeah, he went to a cross. Yeah, he died. Yeah, he rose again. Because I think sometimes often people believe that kind of thing, that truth, that absolute truth of God, but they believe it like they believe in the Easter Bunny or they believe in Santa Claus. You know, oh, yeah, yeah, I think that, yeah. But it's not deep, it's not real, it's not attached, it's not taken them. So saving faith is more than belief. You see, we're told in the Bible of a story of a man that worked at a Philippian prison. And after a while, a bunch of things happened. And if you really want to know the whole story behind it, go read Acts 16. And after these kind of crazy things happened, and Paul and Silas were sharing their faith and through song and through psalms and the Old Testament, this prison worker came to Paul and he asked this question: what must I do to be saved? And Paul simply said to him, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you and your home will be saved. But what we do is we stop there and we don't go any further, and we need to go down to the next verse after that in Acts 16:32. When we really understand what happened. So Paul said to him, you need to believe. So Paul took him, and they all went to the prison worker's home. The prison worker took care of their wounds and fed them and cared for Paul and Silas and all. But here's what happened when they were in the house. When they were in the house, Paul and Silas, the men there, they spoke the word of the Lord to that prison worker and to his family, and all who were in his house heard that. And when they heard what Jesus did, it says that they spoke the word of the Lord to him. They told that Philippian worker, that prison worker, what Jesus has done. And I'm thinking maybe what Paul did is Paul took him back to the Mount of Beatitudes, where Jesus said, if you want to be in my kingdom, you need to be poor in spirit. Where he gave them the Beatitudes, what it is to be a believer in Christ. Maybe Paul took him back to John chapter 6 when Jesus had just fed the 5,000 and that multitude followed him onto the other side of the lake. And Jesus then began to say, you're here just for the food, but let me tell you what you really need. You need to eat my body and drink my blood. And that sounds horrible. And you know what a lot of those disciples did when they heard that? The Bible says in John 6, I think around verse 66, it says that many of his disciples no longer walked with him. Man, it's having an intellectual concept of what God has done is not this saving faith. It's the beginning of it, but it's more. You see, that prison worker had faith in Jesus. He believed in Jesus because he understood what it meant to believe. He understood what Jesus did for him, and he understood who he was before God. Because both in Matthew 5 in the Sermon on the Mount and John 6, after he fed the 5,000, Jesus explains those two very things. And Paul said he took the words of Jesus and shared it with that prison worker, and then he believed. See, if you've been in church any length of time, you've also probably heard a verse out of James chapter 2, verse 19. It says this: you believe that there is one God. You do well. Even the demons believe and they tremble. Oh, wait a minute, Pastor. Demons can't go to heaven. Demons cannot be children of God. True. Absolutely. And yet they believe. They have an understanding. They accept what Jesus says of himself. He is God. Matter of fact, not only do they accept it, they saw it. God created them. Those angels saw God, Jesus, create the world, make man, put man here. They saw God and Jesus place them in the garden and say, you got it all, but don't eat of that tree because you will certainly die. See, the demons have an understanding of truth and they believe that truth. But they don't have faith in Christ. You see, a paraphrase of that verse would be, you say you have faith, for you believe that there is one God. Good for you. Even the demons believe this, and they tremble in terror. John MacArthur says of this text that believing that there is one God is a clear reference to a passage that is most familiar to all Jewish readers. It's called the Shema. The Shema is found in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 and 5, and it says this, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. And what it means and what Jesus is saying in James about the demons is this, the most basic doctrine of the Bible is this, God is one, and the demons believe that. Even the fallen angels affirm the oneness of God and tremble at its implications. Demons are essentially orthodox in faith, in their doctrine, not faith, but in their doctrine. But orthodox doctrine by itself does not have proof of saving faith. Do you understand what I'm saying? It scares me for children to grow up in the church sometimes because from the womb, some of them are hearing the Word of God. And they come out into this world, and man, they're always in church. There's never been a time they ain't heard about God and Jesus and salvation. And they can grow up thinking, yeah, I serve, I come, I do, I this, I'm here, I'm that. I've got saving faith because it's here, but it's not always here. See, these demons knew the truth about God. They knew the truth about Christ. They knew the truth about the Spirit. But those demons hate it. And they hate them. Belief is more than accepting a truth, though that is where it begins with us. So what does it mean to believe? Well, that word in Acts 16 that Paul used to the prison worker means to entrust. It means to have faith. So real true belief is real true faith. Believing means having faith. So we need to understand what it is. We need to understand the core and character of saving faith, believing faith, that shows that one is truly a follower of Christ, a child of God. We Christians call it being saved or being born again. And this is what we see clearly in our text of Mark 7 and Matthew 15. We see the character of saving faith. So my question for you this morning is, not that you call, you know, it's not, are you a Christian? It's not, you know, do you go to church? It's not, and it's not, do you think you'll go to heaven when you die? My question for you this morning is, when you examine your faith, when you examine your life, do you have saving faith? So let me simply just give you quickly four characteristics of saving faith from the account of the Syro-Phoenician woman who came to Jesus. Number one, the character of saving faith is having faith in the person of Jesus Christ. Can't have it any other way. See, the character of saving faith is in a person. Faith is in Jesus Christ. Look at Mark 7, verse 25. For a woman whose young daughter had an unclean spirit heard about him, Jesus, and she came and fell at his feet. Matthew 15, that parallel account, takes it a little bit further and says that at one point she came falling at his feet, worshiping him. See, She came to a person, not a religion. She came to a person who is claimed and will continue to claim and have claimed of himself and proof of himself that he is God incarnate. See, Mark has been answering the question, who is Jesus? And the absolute answer to that question is Jesus is God. So faith, believing faith, saving faith, is coming to God in the person of Jesus Christ and accepting who he is. See, God is not a force. I heard recently, you know, God is not this person, and hopefully I'll say the word right. God is not this person who has an overabundance of midichlorians. What do you say? Yeah, it's those things that the Star Wars people get, and they got the force. You know, that's not God. He's not like that. And he's not simply a spirit that is out there somewhere that is floating around. God is a person. Jesus has always been. He's eternal past. He's present. He's eternal future. To come before God with saving faith, you have to come to Jesus Christ. It's the only way. The first characteristic of this faith is that God is a person that you must approach. He is not simply a religion or an ideology or a dogma that you have determined is that is better than another dogma, but that Jesus is God. This woman understood who Jesus was. Yes, she did. She might not have had full understanding, but she understood that Jesus, his disciples, they were claiming that he was the Messiah. Because when she came to him in Matthew's account, she said, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David." That term, Son of David, is a messianic term, a title. And that woman is saying, you're the one they're saying that's God. You're the one that they are saying that is the Messiah. And I come to you based on that. Now, Jesus never answered her because of that. Jesus just let her speak. He didn't reply, but she came to a person. And beloved, if you're going to have saving faith that brings you into the kingdom of God, that makes you a child of the living God, then you must come to the person of Christ, because there is no other way. And that is the first characteristic of saving faith. Too many people come to a church for religion. Too many people do things that are religious to be that Christian, but that's not what makes you that Christian. It's coming to Jesus. It's approaching him in faith. So the second characteristic of saving faith is this. So now that you've approached Christ, now that maybe he got your attention, maybe he got your attention because you became desperate in life like this woman was. You know what brought that woman to Jesus? I believe it was God leading her there. Because she became so desperate that her daughter was in need and no one and nothing around her could help her. But she heard about this man from Israel that could cast out demons and heal the sick and raise the dead. So her hope was in that person, and she came to that person, Jesus. But what do you do when you get there? What do you do when you're approached with the truths and the claims of Christ like that prison worker was? Well, you know what? What you do is the second characteristic of saving faith, and that is this. The characteristic of faith is penitent. Big word, I know, I'll explain. Being penitent. You know what that really means? It means being sorry for what you are, for what you've done. See, in Matthew 15, verse 22, it says, "And behold, a woman came from that region and cried out to him, saying, 'Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David. My daughter is demon-possessed.'" But the key part is here, have mercy on me. She came to Christ not because of anything good in her. She came to Jesus because all that was good in Christ. She came to Jesus because she had this concept that he would listen, that he would reach out to her if she came and asked for that. She had this understanding of his love and his compassion because she heard the stories. So what is she asking for? What is she doing when she says, have mercy on me? That word mercy is compassion. It's forbearance shown to an offender. Oh, wait a minute. Forbearance, compassion, mercy shown to someone who has offended? She is saying to Jesus, I have offended. I have done wrong. And what she's saying is, I am penitent now of that. I'm sorry that I've sinned against you, O God. I am sorry. I'm remorseful that what I am has offended you. And this is exactly what saving faith must have. There has to be this understanding that we are sorry for what we've done. David, all through the Psalms that he wrote, he worships, he prays, he praises. But you know also what he does? He seeks forgiveness by saying, God, I have messed up and I've done wrong. Psalm 41, verse 4, beautiful verse. David, the psalmist, writes, Lord, be merciful to me. Why? For I have sinned against you. See, what really, really grieves me sometimes is when I've done this, and when I've heard other people come to someone and say, hey, you know what? I want to tell you about Jesus. Will you go to heaven when you die? Oh, well, let me tell you. And then they shortcut the gospel so much so that they just make it this kind of thing that, hey, here's how you go to heaven. But it's so much more than that. You know what going to heaven is? It's icing on the cake. The most important part is when you have saving faith in Christ, you're forgiven of your sins. But to be forgiven of your sin, you have to admit that you're sinful and a sinner. And this is what saving faith is. The second part is being penitent, being sorry, understanding that we've done wrong. See, the thing is, how can we be made right with God until we understand that we're not right with God? And how can we be made right with God until we understand that it is our sin that separates us? And how can we be made right with God when we are not sorry, not remorseful, not penitent for our sin against Him? Because we have offended God. It's not about simply getting into heaven. It's about why we can't get into heaven. And we cannot get into heaven not because we don't try hard enough, not because we don't want to be good, not because we don't go to religious things. We do all kinds of stuff trying to get to God, but we can't get to God because there's a massive barrier in our way, and that is sin. The sinfulness that we have and that we are that needs to be forgiven. And in order to be forgiven, you got to first understand how bad it's hurt God and that you are sorry for that. She said, have mercy on me. Because she got it. She understood it. And see, that second characteristic brings us to the third characteristic of saving faith. And that is this. Saving faith approaches God the Son. You have to come to Jesus. It cannot be any other route. No other God, no other religion, no other anything. It is only Jesus. And that's not what I say. That is what the Father says. God the Father, who created all things, said, there'll be many false religions, but I'm telling you, there is only one God, and I am He. And I will show you that and prove that to you by coming to you. He came as Christ. Jesus came. He's the person. And you must be sorry to that person for your sin. And then thirdly, the characteristic of saving faith is humble, and I've already started talking about this, but it is humble acceptance of who and what you are. Let me explain. This woman came and asked for healing for her child. She knew, she believed that Jesus was able to do it. But Jesus said to this woman, after he didn't reply the first time, after her second, will you do this, repeatedly asking Jesus to heal her child, then he said, she said, would you heal? No, nothing. Son of David, would you heal? Nothing. And then Jesus says this, let the children first be filled, for it is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs. Now you read that text, you're thinking, how derogatory, how prejudiced, how awful it is of Jesus to call her a dog. But she didn't think so. She didn't fight against it. She didn't say, Jesus, how dare you call me a dog? She didn't say, Jesus, you know, that's not politically correct nowadays. You can't use that terminology. You can't say you can't do that kind of thing anymore, Jesus. She didn't say that. You know what she did? Falling at his feet, she says, yes, Lord, you're right. And by her admitting that she was a dog, what she was admitting is not that she was second class, not that she was lower class, not that she was a person to be looked down upon. She was admitting that she had no right to what she was asking for. She's admitting that she had no right or privilege to ask for forgiveness. She didn't deserve it. And she said, I don't come to you based on deserving this, Lord. I come to you based on who you are. And she said this, yeah, you're right. But even the little dogs, the puppies, under the table eat from the master's crumbs. See, all this goes along with what Jesus told the multitude when he spoke to them from the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 5. He said, you want this kingdom of God? You have to be poor in spirit. For he said in Matthew 5, verse 3, blessed, happy, blessed are those who have been poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. What does it mean to be poor in spirit? To be poor in spirit is a confession that says this, I am sinful and rebellious and utterly without moral virtues that are adequate to come before God. It is realizing and accepting that what we are is what we are, a sinner. Being poor in spirit is understanding what Mr. Goodspeed wrote many, 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 many years ago. And he wrote this, being poor in spirit as a virtue must refer not to a poor quality of faith, but the acknowledgement of one's spiritual powerlessness and bankruptcy apart from Christ. They who acknowledge that, who are poor in spirit, who are accepting what the Bible says that they are the ones who will have the kingdom of God. Let me iterate what the Apostle Paul writes about the character, the life, the conduct of all humanity around the world. You see, if you're upset with the fact that we are being told you're a sinner, you don't deserve heaven, you don't deserve Christ, you don't deserve his forgiveness, you don't deserve to be forgiven, you don't deserve any of the goodness of God at all, and we don't. And if you sit here or on the camera and you think, that's so wrong, I don't believe that, I don't agree with that. Well, that's a good start, because you are being pricked by the Spirit of God, and there's conviction, I pray, there. because we are as bad as what the Word of God tells us we are. You know what Paul writes? I'll paraphrase it for speed. The Bible tells us that no one is righteous, not even one person. No one is truly wise with the wisdom that they need to have. No one is seeking God for who God is. We have all turned away. We have all become useless. No one does good. Good to the character of God. Good to that realm. No one does good. Not a single person. Our talk is foul like the stench from an open grave. Our tongues are filled with lies. Snake venom drips from our lips. Our mouths are full of cursing and bitterness. We rush to commit murder. Hatred is murder in the eyes of God. Destruction and misery always follow. We don't even know where to find peace because we have no fear of God at all. That's humanity. That's you and me, Jerry. That's what we were before the Lord opened our understanding and opened our heart and we had saving faith in Christ. See, Jesus called the woman a dog, exposing what she is. And Romans 3 exposes what all of us are. We are people who are sinners. And because of that, we have fallen short of God and continue to fall short no matter what we accomplish or try to accomplish in our lives. We are dogs. We are. But I'm grateful to be a dog because God says you can have what deserve God's gift of forgiveness, but because He freely offers it, we may have it based on Him, not us. She came for the crumbs. She said to Him, "Yes, Lord, even the dogs have the crumbs from the tables, from under the table. Yes, Lord, I am what You say I am. I admit it. I accept it. But I need what You have for me." Amen? Tim Keller explains this humble approach of the woman. This is what it is. You have to humbly come to God and admit an admittance of who you are. You can't be prideful about it because that will block you out of the kingdom. Tim Keller explains, she came because she knew that He was good and that she deserves none of His goodness, but she needed it. And when you and I understand what Jesus has done, the only thing that we can do is humbly come to Him. Listen again to Keller on this. On the cross, the child of God, Jesus, was thrown away, cast away from the table without a crumb so that those of us who were not children of God, you and me, might be adopted and brought into His family. Jesus had to become, so to speak, a dog so that we could become sons and daughters at the King's table. Jesus identified with us so that we can approach Him and have humble, saving,